and a day, today is the day for us to also rejoice and be glad. I want to thank God for this opportunity for us to share the word of God, albeit not as lengthy as it should normally be, but I believe that there's a blessing waiting for you and for me too at this particular point in time that we need to share. Father, we thank you that you are God and there's none like you. All the glory, all the honor that belong to you. Lord, we truly want to say, Lord, we are so glad that we have preserved our lives to see this beautiful day. That it be glorified in the name of Jesus, immortal, invisible, God who alone is wise. We want to thank you, Lord, for even this particular season, in the trouble that we are, for we know that you can make all things to work together for good to those who love you and to those who are called according to your purpose. We declare, Lord, this time will be a time for us for our lifting up, not our casting down in the name of Jesus. I declare everyone listening, your body will be too hot for the devil to attack in the name of Jesus. I ask for the fire of the Holy Spirit to surround our homes, our properties, wherever we are right now, wherever we walk, in the name of Jesus. I pray, Lord, that mark, that untouchable mark, to be upon everyone listening to this particular broadcast today in the name of Jesus. I ask Heavenly Father, Lord, as there was a Passover in Egypt, Lord, let there be a Passover in the name of Jesus. Every demon, everything that has to do with COVID-19, we pass your people over, we pass us over in the name of Jesus. I ask, Lord, we impart, Lord, our world with the light of the gospel. We impart our world with the life of Christ in the name of Jesus. We're not people of fear, we're people of faith. Thank you, Heavenly Father, that you have your way because you are God. Heal our nations, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We are talking today about the calm after the storm. The calm after the storm. I want to read a place in the Bible quickly. It's Mark. Mark chapter 4 from verse 35 to verse 41. And the Bible says, on the same day when evening had come, he said to them, let us cross over to the other side. Now when they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat as he was, and other little boats were also with him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that it was already filling. But he was in the stern, asleep on a pillow. And they awoke him and said to him, Master, or teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? Then he arose and rebuked the wind, and he said to the sea, peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. But he said to them, why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? And they feared exceedingly and said to one another, who can this be that even the wind and the sea obey him? May God bless his word in the name of Jesus. I want to say this first and foremost, that we are in the days of shifting paradigms. The things that we took for granted yesterday have become the novelty of today. Things that we were neglecting as ordinary yesterday, they have become the essentials of today. We have discovered that we are novices in the things we thought we mastered, and we are strangers even in the land that we live. Those unskilled, unappreciated workers of the past have become the most essential and the most honored today. Even the Bible says that sometimes the most unappreciated member of our body, the most unhonored members of our body, they are the most important. And so we are seeing that right now coming to manifestation today. I want to ask, where are those lying politicians? Where are the fund head managers? Where are the business barons? Where are those pampered posters today? Every one of them is in hiding. Everybody's going to hide. And the ones that we have called are those poorly paid people, the chef stackers, the care people. They are the ones that we need today. We need them, and may God bless them in the mighty name of Jesus. This lesson of COVID-19 will last us a lifetime. I want to assure you, we have never known life like this before. And I remember reading from history that there was a Spanish flu in 1918 to 1920 where millions died. Unfortunately, those who were alive then thought it was a one-off. Now we are facing the same thing. And I pray that God will cut the time short because of the elects in the name of Jesus. God is changing the face of the world. God is dispersing and mixing until the land will be for everyone. God is changing. Things are changing. We may not understand what he's doing right now, but eventually, as people of faith, we will understand. Now a time is coming that no one will claim exclusively racial, no one will be saying eternity is theirs. There will be no exclusive racial claim to any territory. No one is immune to the changes that have come and to the changes that are coming. This saga continues. Amen and amen. So what are the lessons I want to learn in this particular storm? Number one is this. The storm we're going through reveals the brevity of life. And this storm teaches us to take advantage of today. Life is short. Life is not 80, 90 years. They are still short. 100 years is still short compared to eternity. So this has taught us that life is short. Life is like, it's like a vapor, the Bible says. And so the Bible says to us in Psalm 90, verse 12. So teach us to number our days that we gain a heart of wisdom. That should be a prayer for everybody, that God should teach everyone how to live our life at this point in time, and that we may gain a heart of wisdom, so we may live in God's freedom. The second thing I want to read for you in this particular area is the book of the preachers. Ecclesiastes 9 verse 10 says, Whatever your hand finds to do, at this point in time, do it with your might. For there is no work or device or knowledge or wisdom in the grave where you are. So the first thing I want to realize is this is the lesson we have been taught in this time is life is short, the brevity of life. And so we must take advantage of this day. The second thing you have to understand is this, that this storm reveals to us that life is not always fear. Life is not always fear. Bad things can happen to good people. Bad things can happen to good people. In the book of Job 1 verse 1, the Bible says there was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was blameless. He was upright. And it was a man who feared God and shunned evil. The same thing is repeated in verse 6 of that chapter 1. But here was a man, the same man that we call Job, lost everything that he had in one day. So we can see from the lesson that we are learning at this point in time is a contemporary lesson for us that bad things can sometimes happen to good people. The third thing you must understand is this, that nothing we see is permanent. Everything changes except God. Everything is temporal. Nothing is permanent. We live in a temporal world. The Bible says in Malachi 3 verse 6, for I am the Lord, only God does not change. It says, for I am the Lord, I do not change. Therefore, you are not consumed, O sons of Jacob. Thank God for the chance that we have. God has not destroyed the world in one go as he did in time of Noah. Okay? So nothing we see is permanent. Everything changes except God. We live in a temporal world. The fourth thing you must understand about the lessons of this storm is that storms reveal that nothing can be taken for granted. Storms reveal that nothing can be taken for granted. Changes in life can be sudden and unexpected. We must be prepared. Christ can come at any time. Changes in life can be sudden, can be unexpected. There were people that we came together into the year with, and today, as of this time, is thousands of people have gone already in Britain. And all over the world, maybe 5,000, 10,000 people have left. And they came into 2020 with hopes. They came into 20 with expectations that this will be the year. Changes can happen unexpectedly. Nothing must be taken for granted, must be prepared. The Bible says to us in 1 Peter 5 verse 8, therefore the Bible says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion seeking who he may devour. Let me say again, storms reveal that nothing can be taken for granted. Changes in life can be sudden and unexpected. We must be prepared. The fifth thing we have to learn here is that storms challenge our spiritual life, and storms reveal the true heart of men. This storm has challenged our spiritual life, and storms do that. They reveal the true heart of men. Storm reveals where our true trust lies, whether we show confidence in people or whether we show our confidence in God. Confidence in men is futile. It's an exercise in futility. The Bible says to us in that Jeremiah 17, 5 to 6. Jeremiah 17, 5 to 6. Thus says the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his strength, whose heart departs from the Lord. For he shall be like a shrub in the desert, and shall not see when good comes, but shall inhabit the parched places in the wilderness, in a salt land which is not inhabited. We cannot afford to put our trust in men. Those people that we trusted before COVID-20, they have disappeared. They have gone to into their place to go. Everybody is hiding. And the Bible says to us, we cannot trust. Even our own heart cannot be trusted. The Bible says the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked, incurably sick. Who can know it? I, the Lord, search the heart. God is searching our hearts. I test the mind to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his doing. Let me say this to you. Eventually, this storm will be over. The immediate concern of everybody, what happens? What do we do when the storm is over? By the grace of God, the storm will be over very soon. We will be able to shake our hands, hug ourselves, visit our families and friends at home, neighbors in the hospital without fear. We will shop without social distancing. The dead will be buried again in decency. In some homes, they will watch the premiership matches again. McDonald's will be on menu for some people. Our children will go back to school, will be at work, and the shouts of hallelujah will be heard again in church buildings. The world will soon smile again. So what will happen after the storm is over and God has now brought in the great calm? I want to say to you, first and foremost, people will realize the failure of men and they will call more on God. Even right now, we're beginning to realize from all over the world that people are turning to God in droves. Those who are vaccinated are coming back to God. There's repentance. Those who have seen the spiritual side of the pandemic, they are repenting. There's a restoration of hope for those who have lost their hope. There's a revival of faith in God and in humanity. There will also be economic recovery in the name of Jesus. Nations will realize now they can do a lot of things without depending on other nations. China may just stop becoming the workshop of the world. Nations will realize that they need to rebuild their own infrastructures and keep their own economy for growth. One thing this storm has revealed is that nations can close borders just like that, even to their closest neighbors and to their own people. Have you not noticed a lot of nations that were friendly, they closed their borders and nobody is complaining? So that means this thing can happen just like that. But I am believing after this storm, when the calm has not come, there will be a release of ideas that have never been seen before. They say necessity is the mother of inventions. I believe that God will impart ideas into the souls of Christians, that they will go there. The Bible says the riches of the Gentiles has been turned over to us. We will have ideas. We will go there and we will just do a lot of good stuff in the name of Jesus. I have now seen how car manufacturers are now turning from making cars. Cars are not selling now. But you know what is selling? Hospital equipment are selling. They are now making hospital equipment. In a short while, within days, within weeks, hospitals were being built. Even in England here, Nightingale Hospital was filled. Within days, an empty place became a hospital. And that is what is happening right now. The third thing that will happen is there will be a political aftermath. We will refocus on national pride. People will appreciate the goodness of their own countries and their own people. National pride will be restored. It might even happen. People start having holidays in their own nations instead of going all over the whole world, and they will buy things made by local companies instead of exporting things that are very exotic. There will also be a rediscovery of family fundamentals. There will be homes will be stronger than before. Families will become the focus of society, not organized groups, not sports, not recreation. Because right now, families have rediscovered themselves. Husband has just discovered the wife, and children are enjoying their parents again. And that is a blessing. It must have been a blessing in disguise. There will be also, hear me, there will be an aftermath for the church. Church without walls will replace church buildings. All this money, all these churches that we have built with opulence, that we have built with a lot of money, they will have less relevance. Church, we will realize that people matter than bricks. The church will become sparingly used because people will trust more. They will use more of technology. And there will also be a time to rebuild careers, businesses, a great time for investment. I was just reading and I heard that England has already used up everything that is stocked for a no-deal scenario with Europe. They have been saving all the things that they have, everything is being used up. So imagine if Europe should close its door, who will reproduce those things? We do that. And so I'm believing that this will be a time for those who are in business in the church to go out there and begin to flourish and replenish in the name of Jesus. Apart from food, I'm saying a lot of things become cheap because nobody wants to buy and they want to sell. And I want to conclude by saying this. Let me read to you again, book of Mark 4, from verse 34 to verse 41. The Bible says, on the same day when evening had come. Understand this, that the time to conclude the business of any day is in the evening. For the night is coming when no man can walk. The time to wrap up the business of the world has come. Christ is coming very soon. The time for believers to rest is very near. And he said, Jesus was the one who said to them, let us cross over to the other side. Christ is always proactive. Nothing catches him by surprise. He saw ahead and he told them, let's go on to the other side. The other side is a place that is unknown to man. It's never our intention to cross to the other side. We love to stay in our comfortable zone. And that is why this thing that is happening is not a comfortable time for everybody. But we understand eventually that God meant it for good. To cross over takes a great effort and determination. We don't necessarily want to go, we don't see the end from the beginning. That is God's realm. Cross to the other side can be very painful and stressful. Man will do everything to avoid pain. Crossing to the other side can be very painful and very stressful. Man will do everything to avoid pain. Verse 6 now says, when they had left the multitude, crossing over means you're going to leave people who are familiar to you. You're going to leave a familiar terrain. We are leaving people who are familiar. A lot of people have lost their parents. They have lost friends. Yes, I'm not saying that's necessarily a good thing, but it does happen that sometimes there are people that who are familiar that are holding us back. So when we cross to the other side, we may end up leaving people that we love so that we can go and fulfill gospel for our own lives. And the Bible says they took him along in the boat as he was. Christ was taken as he was, nothing added. And other little boats were with them. Listen to me. God will always have witnesses when he does his own thing. He always have remnants in the process of any storm. 37 now says, and a great windstorm arose. The devil doesn't know how to do anything good, but he knows how to stir up troubles and how to orchestrate disasters. And the Bible says, and the waves beat into the boat so that it was already filling. It may appear that life is ending now for you, but as long as Christ is in your boat, there's a hope for survival and you will flourish in the name of Jesus. But as Jesus says, he was in the stern, asleep on the pillow. The Lord always finds comfort in the middle of every storm. Why? Because he knows the end from the beginning. And he arose and he rebuked and said, peace be still. And there was a great storm. And he told them, why are you fearful? How is that you have no faith? Can you see fear and faith? Right now, even men of faith are fearful. But fear is not a portion. We are the ones that should go out there and inject people what? With faith. Storms can bring unexpected reactions from different people. But at this point in time, faith is what we are meant to be showing. Let me just share this with you before I go. Let me just let you know this truth, that new challenges, the other side will bring to us new challenges that will test the resolve of the strongest and the most determined. The other side will test with challenges, will test us with challenges. We have not seen how this thing will pan out, but we are believing that all things will work together for good. Number two is this, that growth and expansion is waiting for us on the other side. After this is over, we're going to see joy in the name of Jesus. And there will be a great reward for everyone who is holding on to faith in Christ. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for this time. Lord, again, in the name of Jesus, give all the glory. I want to thank you for the people who are behind this recording. I thank you for those who are going to be listening to it. I thank you, Lord, for what this thing will do to lives who will listen to it, Lord. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that all of us will see the end of this COVID-19 experience. We will tell our children and our children's children, and God will have all the glory. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Father, I want to thank you again for those our frontline workers, key workers, medical doctors, nurses, caregivers, care workers, Lord, those who are stacking shelves, who are working in supermarkets and shops, those who are doing things right now that are moving the nation forward. I pray, Lord, you will uphold them in Jesus' name. You will guide them. Not only will you protect them, Lord, they will be used as vessels for healing in the mighty name of Jesus. I declare wherever they go shall be Goshen in the name of Jesus. The evil power of this time will not see them in Jesus' name. They will become invisible. for every COVID-19 virus in the name of Jesus. The fire of God will go ahead of them in the mighty name of Jesus to destroy whatever may want to inhabit them or touch them. Lord, there will be light in the midst of darkness. There will be solutions to the problems of this time in Jesus' name. Father, use them mightily. I pray for those again, Lord, who are praying for this nation at this point in time. Intercessors, Lord, you also uphold them, give them strength. Those who have lost family, Lord, comfort them in the name of Jesus. And those who are right now struggling in the hospital, that you heal them. Thank you, Heavenly Father, you will be that glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you.